Recently, I get too little time to play CTFs, but John Hammond, who also has a CTF and hacking YouTube channel, approached me and asked if I was playing the Google CTF 2018, and so I was persuaded into playing a few hours with him. Because we are both noobs, we chose a challenge that already had high number of solves, this way we know it shouldn't be too hard and thus perfect for us. JS Safe 2.0 was a web challenge for the Google CTF 2018. You stumble upon someone's JS Safe on the web. It's a simple HTML file that can store secrets in the browser's local storage. This means that you won't be able to extract any secrets from it. The secrets are on the computer of the owner. But it looks like it was handcrafted to work only with the password of the owner. Okay. So let's download the attachment, which is a zip file, and unpack it. There's a single JS Safe to HTML file in it. So let's open it in Chrome and have a first look at it. We have a key input field and a cool spinning cube animation. If we enter something, we get an access denied and we have to reload the page to try again. Next, let's have a look at the source code. There are some texts here, so let's read them because maybe they provide some hints for us. JS Safe version 2.0, the leading local storage-based safe solution with military-grade JS anti-debug technology. Anti-debug, okay, that already sounds annoying. Let's see what that is about. Advertisement. Looking for a handcrafted browser-based virtual safe to store your most interesting secrets? Look no further, you have found it. You can order your own by sending a mail to jssafe@example.com. When ordering, please specify the password you would like to use to open and close the safe. We will handcraft a unique safe just for you that only works with your password of choice. Whoa, I'm sold. Then we have some CSS. And oh, keyframe animations. The cube is actually animated in HTML and CSS, no WebGL or anything. That's a cool solution. And then we have two scripts here. One is minified and the other one not. Down here we see the keyhole input element, which on a change, so when we enter a key, we'll call open safe. And that function will execute a regular expression on our input, so it has to be this flag format. So our input password has to start with CTF and in curly braces some regular characters. This means the correct password for the safe will also be the solution, the flag that we can submit for points. And then it will call X with the extracted password. So it will call X with the part inside of the curly braces, and if X returns a zero or false, it will fail and return with denied. But if that function X returned a 1 or true, it will do the stuff here and show the access is granted. Now, simply removing the check here and jump to granted doesn't help us because the challenge is about finding the correct password, that is the flag. So we have to check out the function X. Now, X is up here in the minified version. I will copy this file now to keep the original, but then we can use JS Beautifier to prettify the script and work with this now. Immediately, that really weird string is poking out, but let's see. X first defines three helper functions. ORD to get the number, the char code for a given character, CHR is converting from a number to the character string, and STR is simply making sure that a value is a string. This is pretty much the JavaScript equivalent for the Python functions ORD, CHR, and STR. Then X defines two functions, H and C. H is a bit weird, it takes a string, sums up values onto A and B and then returns some stuff. And C is a for loop over the A input and it appears to XOR the A string with the key B. So C is a, I guess, just a XOR implementation. Then there is a for loop calling debugger many times. I guess that's the anti-debugging trick. And then we call H on the string X, and X is our password we gave in as a parameter. And after that, we define this source, overwrite the to string of it. So if you would attempt to get the string representation of source, it would call XOR decryption with itself again, and X? No clue what the F that does. And then we have a try catch that attempts to eval the eval of an XOR on source and X. Very odd. Let's move on to a more dynamic approach and see if we can debug this. We can open up the developer tools and go to the sources tab. And then let's set a breakpoint just before we pass our password to the X function by clicking the line number here. And then let's enter an easy test input with CTF, curly brace, AAA, BBB. Boom, breakpoint hit. And now we can investigate. So at this point, the regex was already executed and password looks like this. And the second element of password is passed to X as a parameter. Then let's single step forward into X. But at some point we reach a debugger loop. So let's remove that first. Now here you have to be very careful. A very simple mistake you could make here is to remove the whole loop. But the function H uses A and B. If A is undefined, then initialize it with 1, but A is used in this loop here. And I think because the loop variable is here not defined with the var keyword, it makes the variable extend out of the scope of the loop. So it affects the global state of A. So actually A is 1000 when H is called right afterwards. So you just have to make the loop empty. So let's rerun this change with our input. Cool. Now we reach the H. So H gets passed in the X, right? And X was the parameter of the function. So it's our password, right? But when you print X now with the developer tools, it prints the function X instead. The function X uses the parameter X, and str on X will simply get the source code of X as a string. Is it a bug of the developer tools, or is H really using the source code of X? Let's single step forward into H and let's see. No, the parameter S is in fact the source code of our function, and it now loops over this string character by character, and is now creating a sum of these characters with A and B. If we let the loop run, we can inspect the final stage of A and B, and now that it assembles into a string and returns. Here's another easy mistake you could make. We modified the code, right? We replaced the debugger statement and we beautified the code. It was minified before. So now we pass in a wrong string to H. So let's go back to our original HTML file and try to extract the correct source string. To do that, I open the developer tools and set a breakpoint again just before we call X. Then we can let it run until it hits the debugger loop. And to bypass it now, I simply set A to a very high value by hand so we don't have to execute that 1000 times, and then we can single step forward into H. And now here we get S. By the way, if you prettify on the fly with the Chrome developer tools like that, that doesn't affect the string source of the function. It's not modifying the real sources, so no worries here. We can also quickly verify that indeed the A used inside of H is already at 1000 because of the loop before. Cool. So let's copy that string into our modified version and hard code that as a parameter for that call to H. But just to make sure we got everything right, let's go back to the original source, set a breakpoint after loop and extract the final state of A and B. This way we can verify that with the hard-coded parameter we get the same result. So 2714 and 33310. We go to our modified HTML again, set a breakpoint at the end of H and let it run, and we check A and B and yes, same values. Perfect. Now let's step forward again. Now we reached this weird source string. Okay, we set it, we overwrite the toString function, and now we call console.log on the source. I assume that will trigger the toString function, and then does this call to C with recursively itself? Not really sure what JavaScript will do in this case. I'm not that familiar with quirky code like that. But in any way, our single step attempt over console.log caused the debugger to become unresponsive, and after 30 seconds or so, the whole tab is killed by Chrome. Okay, that really looks like anti-debugging here. I wonder if it's just that line here that is bad or more. I remove it for now and try it again, with a breakpoint here. Run again, but damn, it will again hang. That was probably the most annoying part of where I spent the most time on, because I needed to get some way to debug and get visibility into the code, but it always hangs. My assumption was it has to do with this overwritten to a string, and I kinda assumed that the developer tools, when trying to display variables in the current scope, will try to get the string representation, and then that causes a denial of service. So I played around with that a lot and tried different things, debug statements in different places, changing the toString, adding a console log outputs, and so forth. Probably did that easily for an hour or more, but then I had a big breakthrough. One of my tests was console log in the XOR decryption function to print the XOR result, the C. Check it out, it printed two outputs, and while they both look like garbage data, the first one definitely isn't. This is JavaScript code. X equal equal, and then a call to C, the XOR decryption, with some crazy string, and as an XOR key, it will call H with X. So at this point, X has to be equal to this part decrypted with a key that is derived from X as well. So, two questions. What is X at this point, and how does this fit into the larger picture? Let's look at the latter one first. When you look at the eval, you see that it is an eval inside an eval. And the first call to XOR decrypt, so the innermost eval, resulted in this X equal equal. And then this eval will now execute that string. And that string has another call to C, which is this output. So the eval compares this output to the X. That is then either true or false. And then that result is eval 2 and returned from this function. And if this returned a true, we get into the access granted. Okay, how does that X work? Is that X again the source code of the function X? A simple way to find out what is X is to add a console log inside of H, because X is passed into that, and when we do that and run it with our test input, we of course see the first call to H with the source code, but then the second time it uses our input string. So this time X is not the source code, but it's the parameter. What the F? I don't understand JavaScript namespacing or variable scopes. God damn it. I didn't fully investigate that, but I guess it has to do with the with statement. There's a short quote from the Mozilla developer docs. The with statement makes it hard for a human reader or JavaScript compiler to decide whether an unqualified name will be found along the scope chain, and if so, in which object. Okay, basically nobody in the world knows what it does. It just does what we observe here. Anyway, now we basically have everything we need to solve it. Our input has to generate the correct XOR key when passed to H to decrypt this string with XOR to the original input again. I want you to take a second and think about what the weakness here is. How can this be attacked? How can we possibly find the correct input that decrypts to the correct input? Isn't that a chicken and egg problem? Well, the fail is the H function. H is essentially a key or password derivation function. It takes a secret or a seed and generates a key, in this case used for XOR, based on some kind of algorithm. It doesn't really matter now what H exactly does, important is just that the result of H is always 4 bytes. The XOR decryption only uses a 4 byte key that is obviously always repeated. So no matter what our input is, the secret can be decrypted with the correct key, and the decrypted result has to be a valid character in our flag. And that is super easy to brute force now, because of the repeating nature of the key. We can brute force each byte of the key individually. Basically, we take every fourth byte of the secret and decrypt it with the first key byte. We brute force all 256 possible byte values, and if one results in all of the chars to be valid characters, it's a good chance that that key is real. And we do the same for each fourth byte, starting with the second and so forth. Makes sense, right? And if we do that and combine all four bytes together, we are able to find a possible decrypted secret, which of course is now tested against our input, which means this is the flag input. We can test it. CTF curly braces. Next version has anti-debug. Access granted. And we can submit the string now to the CTF and get points. Awesome. By the way, you should check out John Hammond's YouTube channel. He has a lot of CTF video write-ups as well and could use a few new subscribers. He also has a bit more content about the Google CTF.